All right, good to see you guys again. Just in time for the warm weather. So today we're gonna continue our discussion about Bayesian classification. And to give you a sense of what we're trying to do is imagine we have some space that we have data for. And this space we're gonna define by some vector that has two components, you know, say x2 and x1. We have this vector x. It's our data, x1 and x2. And we have, for every data point, we have some classification for this data point. And we're gonna think that this guy, this classification, belongs to maybe class 0, class 1, you know, up to some other class n. And basically, our objective for today is to think about this space, and you know, we have some data points here. This is one class. This is some other class. Maybe some other class. And in this space, if you wanted to plot the posterior probability, so probability that the class is equal to, say, class 1, given the input x, what would this posterior probability look like? And what would it look like for another one, probability that class is equal to 0, given x? And what we're going to see is that this function that's going to have some shape out here has a special property. And basically, that property is that if you look at the ratio between these guys, this is going to be some function of x. And this function of x, we can describe some closed form representation for it. So the ratio of the posterior probabilities, which is basically if you wanted to plot the ratio of belonging to one class versus to another class to one of these dots at some region, what would this function look like? It turns out that there's a nice solution for that. And I want to show you that. But at the end of the day, basically what you want to do is to be able to take your data and say, based on this class labels that you've given me, there's some function that I'm going to be able to draw that, you know, separates these classes. And we're going to be able to understand something about the nature of this boundary. So is it a linear function? Is it a quadratic function? What is it? And also the shape of this ratio. So when this is equal to 0, that's my boundary between two classes, right? So when the posterior probabilities are the same, log of this, sorry. When log of it is equal to 0, that's when the posterior probabilities are the same, so then you get this boundary between classes. All right. And that we're also going to talk a little bit about what happens if you have data that is missing some component of it. So I'm going to give you some data x that has nothing here, and then, you know, some number here. And so what you should do with that, when you have missing data, how should you classify things? So another useful thing to know about. All right, that's where we're going. Any questions before we get started? Okay. Oh, the one last thing I want to teach you today is we talk a lot about normal distributions and how we, you know, we're going to look at the ratio of these posterior probabilities when the data, your likelihoods are normally distributed with equal or unequal variance. So what if you don't have normal data? What if you have some, you know, some data that doesn't look normal? So what if you have data that, you know, you have some probabilities that sort of, you know, look like some, you know, if you look at the distribution, maybe this is how it looks like. So how do you represent the probability distribution, first of all, to begin with, for something like this? If you don't want it to assume to be Gaussian, what should you do with this? And then how do you compute the posterior probability? So what we're going to see is a technique called kernel-based estimates of density, which basically what it does is that, so we're going to form a likelihood function that's made up of a little kernels everywhere we have a data point. So whatever distribution of data that you have is what you've measured. We're going to put a little kernel every location where you had a data point, and then add it all up, and that becomes our distribution. And we can do, you know, analysis on it the same way as if it was a, you know, a normal distribution. Of course, we won't be able to get closed form solution for it, but you'll be able to compute everything that, I've been describing by, you know, using your computer to form these probabilities. Okay? All right. So let's get started. So we have some data that looks like this. We have a vector that tells us our features. We have a class that's been assigned to it, and we have a bunch of these. And our classes belong to some domain that goes from 0 to L, number of classes that we have. And what we want to do is to assign our data, class X. The class that we're going to assign to data point X is going to be the one that maximizes over some range of numbers of classes, you know, from 0 to L, the posterior probability that it belongs to that class, given that we have the data. And we know that this posterior probability is dependent on our likelihood of our data times our prior divided by the marginal, where we've integrated out our data. So what is P of X? Is just the sum of all the probabilities integrated out the classes. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to model the ratio of the posterior probability of class 1 versus class 0. So basically, we want to model the log of the probability of being class 1 given X to the probability of being some other class given X. And what we want to see is that, what is this function? How does this look like as a function of X? And we'll do it for a couple of normal distributions, Gaussians to begin with. And the Gaussians that we will consider are going to be the ones where the variances are variances of the likelihoods. So the likelihood function is going to have variances that are equal versus unequal. So I'm going to begin with equal variance likelihoods. And so what does this mean? So, you know, we have some data when we have class 0, and this is some normal with some mean. And we also have some data when we have class 1. This is also some normal with some other mean and variance. And so when the variances are equal, when sigma squared of the two likelihoods are the same, then we're going to have a special condition here. And this is going to be a particularly simple form of this likelihood ratio, this posterior ratio. Now, keep in mind, so why am I trying to find this log of the ratio of the posteriors? Why is this useful thing to find? Well, certainly finding the boundary would be useful, because when the ratio of the posterior logs is equal to 0, then that's precisely the boundary, right? But also, it's not just that point. Every other point, you know, every other x is going to give me a number that's going to say, how much more likely is it for it to belong to this class versus any other class? And it's a ratio of the posteriors. And if we have a closed form solution for it, then we have a model that takes our space, this space here, and puts on top of it ratio of probabilities. So for every two classes, I can tell you how much more likely one class is with respect to the other as a function of the entire space. So that's what we're after. Does that make sense? All right. Okay. So let's look at it graphically to begin with. So so let's begin with a likelihood that has the same variance under the two classes. So this is P of X given that class is 1. This is P of X given that class is 0. And, you know, suppose that my prior probability of class 0 is equal to the probability of class 1. So when I multiply the likelihoods by the priors, I get basically the same thing. So what I plotted here is the likelihood times the prior probability. Okay, so what's my marginal going to look like? My marginal is going to be the sum of these two functions. So P of X is going to look like this. Something like this. And now, when I want to look at my decision, which is the log of the posteriors, well, that's just the log of this term, the likelihood, times the prior. Which is going to look like this. It's going to be a line. Which is kind of surprising, right? You take this function here and you divide it by this function and then find the log of that, somehow you're going to get a line. Is that true? Let me show you why. So what's my likelihood? Well, that's P of X for some class. And let's suppose we're saying that it's a normal. So we're going to have a normal distribution. With variance sigma. And I'm going to assume that my X is a vector of size M. So that's my probability for the likelihood of X given that C is equal to 1. And suppose that I have a prior probability of C1 be Q1. So what's the log of my likelihood times the prior probability? let's write this out. So this is going to be log of the first term plus log of the second term, log of the third term times log of Q1. So that's so the log of the denominator of our ratio I have one more term here, plus log of Q1. It's going to be, this term is going to be the same, this term is going to be the same, this term is going to be, this part of it is going to be different, so minus 1/2 x transpose. So when I have the log of P of X, C is equal to 1, probability C is equal to 1, P of X, C is equal to 0, probability of C is equal to 0, that's just this equation minus this equation. And so if we subtract these things from up here, what do I get? I get this term survives, this term survives, and then a whole bunch of constants survive. This survives, this survives, this survives, and this survives. So we have a linear function in terms of x, and we have a constant. So what that's equal to is x transpose w, some vector w, just a linear function here, plus a constant W0, these terms here. Which is this line that I drew here. Okay, so when you have likelihoods that come from variances that are equal between the classes, then the ratio of the posterior probabilities is going to be a linear function of the input vector x. Does that make sense? Okay, so our decision boundary is going to be linear. Right. Okay. So I have a picture to show you for this, since it's going to be so much easier for me to actually show it to you. So look at this image here. So you have a vector space that has x2 and x1. So that's my vector space, and I have some data points that are blue, some data points that are green, some data points that are red. Okay, and what I've done is that I've plotted lines where the ratio of the posterior probabilities is 0. And I have made a grayscale everywhere where the numerator is bigger than the denominator. So for class 2, with respect to any other class, this region has the bigger value than 0.5, basically. The log of it is greater, the log of it is positive. So class 2 has the highest posterior probability here. Class 1 has the highest posterior probability here. Class 3 has the highest posterior probability here. And their decision boundaries are shown here. So I cross the decision boundary here, but class 1 still wins in both sides. Do you have any questions about that? So when the variances of the two likelihoods is the same, then my decision boundary is linear. Okay, very good. All right, let's now consider unequal variance of likelihoods. Okay. So basically what I want is a scenario where I have one likelihood that looks like this, I have another likelihood that looks like this. So P of X given class 0 is a normal with mu 0 sigma 0 squared, but P of X given class 1 is a normal with mu 1 and sigma 1 squared. So sigma 1 is not equal to sigma 2. And so this is going to be some normal that we can write. All right, so that's our x, and we have two places that's of interest to us here. You see the likelihoods crossing at these two places. And again, assuming that our prior probabilities, for the purpose of plotting, let's assume that the prior probabilities are equal. If they're not, they just would scale this up and down. And let's plot the posterior probabilities. What is that going to look like? That's going to be the ratio of, this is P of X given class 1. This is P of X given class 0. So the ratio of the posterior probabilities, these are the likelihoods, but when we multiply it by the prior probabilities, we're going to get a ratio that's going to be equal to the ratio of the posterior probabilities. And so this class 1 is bigger than class 0 here. So for class 1, you're going to have a higher probability. Then it's going to cross. It's going to come up. It's going to look like this. This is the posterior probability of class 1 given x. Whereas for the other class, it's going to look like this. Right, so the posterior probability for class 0 is highest here because its likelihood is highest. So what's the decision boundary going to look like? Well, suppose we want to plot the log of P of X given class 0 times the prior probability of class 0. So suppose that's what I want to plot. So again, this is x. This is 0 when x is 0. So class 0 is going to be more likely up here, so it's going to have some positive number here. And then class 1 is more likely here. Class 1 is more likely here. So the function that I'm going to end up with is going to look like this. And we're going to see that it's a quadratic function of x. This is the log of the posterior. Okay, let's see this. So my claim is that this is a quadratic function. All right, so let's compute what this is. So we can write the log of the likelihood times the prior for each case. And let's now think about the ratio, which is the log of the p of x given that c is equal to 1 times the prior probability. So some of the terms that we used to cancel no longer cancel because the variances are different. We're going to get these quadratic terms that remain. Plus some constants. So if you look at what I have left, I have a quadratic term in x, I have a linear term in x, plus some constants, which means that the ratio of the posterior probabilities can be written as follows. There's some quadratic set of weights that are gonna influence our function. That's this first term. Then there's going to be, these first two terms are quadratic terms. And then we have some linear terms, which is this x transpose times a vector plus a constant term. So that means the ratio of the posterior probability is a quadratic function of input x. All right, so let me show you that here with some data. There it is. So same data as before, we have some space, x space, here's x2, here's x1 of our vector. We have some blue data points, green data points, red data points. We want to be able to separate these guys using Bayes probability. So what we do is that we compute the mean for each class, we compute the variance for each class, then we compute the posterior probabilities, the ratio of the posterior probabilities, and if you look at these boundaries here, they're quadratic functions. And by measuring the ratio of the probabilities, I can then color the classification, right? I can tell you what's green, what's red, and what's blue. And of course, you know, if you look at it, there's some blues here that are inside the reds, there's some greens here that are inside the reds, but that's just the way it goes, right? That's how you maximize the posterior probability. Yeah.
Do you have the classification accuracy there doesn't look very good.
Right, but you know, it's as good as you can do using the normal distribution that as our what we started, right? So the next thing we're going to do is to get rid of the normal distribution. Let's get the distribution of our data itself. So we'll do the kernel-based estimate of density rather than a normal-based estimate. And you'll see that. I'll show you how that goes. Yeah. Okay. So far, what we've seen is that if we have normal distributions of equal variance, the ratio of our posteriors is going to be a linear function of x. If we have non-equal variances associated with our likelihoods, then you're going to get a quadratic function of x. And now let's look at what happens if you don't want to use normals at all, if you want to use something else. All right, so density-based estimates. So we're going to use a kernel. All right, so we're going to compute likelihoods when the data are not normally distributed. And in particular, we want to have a smoothing coefficient in our kernels so that you can make it as jaggedy as you like or as smooth as you like when you estimate your densities. So you will see that based on this parameter, we're going to get boundaries that are going to be smooth or, you know, meander between things. And that's going to be a property of our kernel. So basically, the idea being that if you have, you know, some histogram of your data that looks like, you know, something like this, you know, can I describe its probability distribution using the data itself rather than a parametric approach where I would find the mean and the variance of this and say that it's the best that I can do using a normal distribution. So kernel density estimates. So basically the idea is that every place that you have a data, you're going to put in a little Gaussian. And then your distribution is going to be the sum of all those Gaussians that you placed. Of course, you'd have to normalize them based on the number of data points. And the Gaussian that we're going to place is going to have a parameter that's going to tell us its smoothness, essentially. How far away from this place where the data was am I going to make my variant. So if it's really smooth, right, if it has a big shoulder, then it's going to take your data point and the next data point, and it's going to bring them together. But if your kernel is sharp, then it's going to say, this data point is separate from data point, so I'm going to do this. That's how my density is going to look like. So this is a parameter that you're going to have to set when you look at your data, and it's a user-defined. So here's our kernel. K, as a function of U, is this. This is for a single-dimensional problem. We'll do it for multi-dimensional in just a second. So this is the definition of our kernel. And we have some data point xi. And we have n is our number of data points. So then my likelihood, probability x, given that it belongs to class 1, is going to be defined as follows. Take all the data points that you've said belong to that class, say you have n of them, and you have some parameter h, which h is going to be the parameter that's going to be a part of our kernel, and then we're going to sum our kernels, I is equal to 1 to n of all our kernels as a function of x minus xi divided by h. So here's my kernel. It's defined in terms of some input u. That input is going to be x minus the mean, which is where the data point you actually had, divided by h. H is like a variance, if you will, of your kernel that you're describing. So the bigger the h is, the smoother your density is going to look like. Yeah?
How do you define the size of the kernel?
You mean the width?
The width, yes.
Yeah, so that's going to be h. And you'll see it's the variance of it, right? Otherwise, it's normalized. Right, so we're going to place its mean. We have only two things about the kernel. We have its mean and we have its variance, right? We're going to place its mean where your data point is, and the variance, you're going to have to pick it. And you're going to see that depending on how you pick it, you're going to get a density that's really smooth or really jaggedy.
So it would depend on how you define your histogram.
Well, your histogram is your data.
Yes, but imagine, for example, if the x-axis is a continuous spectrum, not... example, voxels.
Right.
Imagine a time scale.
Yeah.
You have to define
yes.
the time
yes.
bin for the
yes.
histogram.
So exactly.
The kernel would be the same as the time bin of the histogram.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah. Yeah, I've been talking about it in terms of a discrete,
right.
digitized, if you will, at some samples. Yeah. So let me show you what happens if x is a vector, and then we'll see what this looks like. So if x is a vector, then the kernel is, you know, the same way you would have it for a Gaussian. And then the likelihood is normalized based on the degrees of freedom in your vectors. As follows. So let me just summarize this before I show you some examples of it. So you take your label data. And you form the likelihood p of x for some class with mean and variance of each class. And then you form these log ratios between them at every point in x, and given some new data point, that's unlabeled, you can form the probability of belonging to some class given your data. Because you have the model that says, what the ratio of the posterior probabilities are. So let me show you this kernel thing so we can see how it would look like. So here's some data that you have here. And you know, if you just fit a Gaussian to it, here's what it would look like. And down here, I have a couple of plots of examples of a kernel density estimate. So if the variance is high, 1.5, you get the red shape. If it's small, 1, you get this black, more jaggedy shape. And if we do the same problem that we did before, here's our problem, red, green, blue. Now you get boundaries that are, you know, not quadratic. They're complicated, right? They're going in and out. And you can make it as jaggedy as you like with that parameter h that I described. Yeah?
In practice, how do you select that value?
Usually you would have a test set that you're testing against, and you'd be some mechanism by which, you know, you would say, all right, well, how does it do after training on some, you know, some other data? All right. Yeah.
And you notice that those summations are over your labeled data, like the points that are labeled as class 1 versus class 0 or so on and so forth.
Right, right. Yeah. So when you say the summations, you mean for the ratio of the posterior?
The
kernels?
Can you find likelihood of like data?
For the kernels?
Given, what was it?
The posterior likelihood.
Oh, just in general, the posterior likelihoods. The posteriors, you mean? Or the kernels?
Uh-huh.
Oh, the OneNote, sorry.
Right,
I guess it's the same thing, but yeah.
The summation from I equals 1 to n, that is for...
Here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's across only a subset of the data. That is for class 1.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Only for subset. Because remember, we're using this to compute the likelihood.
Yeah.
So is P of x given that it's class 1?
So at the end of the day, if I was making that plot, even at the end, I would take a specific, I take a data point. I would take only the kernels for class 1.
That's right.
I put that into there, and that's right. Posterior for that. So.
Yeah. So you see, it's just another way to compute a likelihood.
Sure.
But you're doing it as a sum of Gaussians rather than a Gaussian. Does that make sense? Yeah, question.
Yeah, so in this case, your smoothness is the same for all
the
points.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But in principle, you could use different values.
That's right. Yeah, you could make it so that some data points have... Why would you do it that way?
Well, suppose you know a little bit more about some of your data points, and you know
beautiful.
How much confidence you have in each.
Beautiful, yeah. Lovely, right? So sigma is an estimate of your uncertainty about that data point, right? So you can weigh it in your density estimate based on your uncertainty. It's a beautiful way to incorporate these ideas. It's really, you know, empowering, I think, to analyze data using probabilities. Once you have a concept of uncertainty, that being associated with a variance, have a way to estimate it, then things like densities become very much dependent on those beliefs that you have. And, you know, ratio of posteriors is really ratio of hypotheses that you have. You know, hypothesis A versus hypothesis B, that's what you're really testing when you're looking at these ratios. Which class does it belong to? And you get a probability. So you say, with this probability, I can tell you this data belongs to this class. Not just that, you know, it's more likely, but with this probability, I can tell you that. So before I give you the last part of the lecture, which is about missing data, this is sort of related to what we're talking about now. You know, this kind of thinking, this is the way scientists think, right? This is data-based, based on evidence. But unfortunately, this is not how humans think. Humans, you know, you have all kinds of beliefs, which may have nothing to do with data. And it's one of the difficult things in the question of how does one change people's opinions. I was listening to Daniel Kahneman. He's a Nobel Prize economist, psychologist. And they were asking him questions about, well, how does one approach the problem of global warming when you want to talk to people about it? Because there's all this data, you know, and you can say with some probability that the Earth is warming and these are the things that will happen, but that doesn't seem to change people's minds. Some people just, you know, don't believe it because they see some disagreement among scientists that, you know, 80% of scientists believe it, but 20% of scientists don't. So therefore, that causes doubt. And I was reminded of the fact that, you know, in our class, we talk about probabilities. We used evidence-based process of inference, but that's not how the brain works. You can believe lots of things that have very little to do with actual evidence. And it's hard for us to come around to think logically. And maybe, you know, this is a good way to build machines, but it doesn't appear to be the way we're built. Or our priors are very different. Maybe that's another way to, you know, to think about it. Okay, our last topic, missing data. Yeah.
So, in a continuous spectrum, you would use the Gaussian distribution to have a more proper function.
Yeah.
But, for example, when you're actually simulating, you use discrete functions to compute. So, why wouldn't you use just a linear function that derives PDF from your histogram? Why would you use the
kernel?
The kernel.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, my experience with, I guess I don't have a whole lot of experience with continuous functions, so I don't know if I can tell you from my own history if one way or the other. I'm ignorant of it, basically. I want you to know. I would guess that the reason why to use kernel-based estimates is because you don't have a lot of data. And, you know, if you have a lot of data, then more than likely, a typical distribution is going to work just fine. But sparse data is probably better approached with these kernel-based estimates. Okay. All right, missing data. A fairly common problem that you might come across. So let me give you an example of it. So we have our input space, X. So here's X2, here's X1. And let's pick some coordinate system. Say this is 0. This is 0. And I'm going to plot likelihoods for you. So maybe class 2 has some likelihood that looks like this. This is class 2. Maybe class 1 is up here. This is class 1. So what am I plotting? I'm plotting P of X given C. I'm plotting the likelihood on top of the x coordinates. Maybe I have another class over here. This is class 3. And maybe some class here. Class 4. And let's just, to make our life easier, let's say this is minus 1. And this is plus 1. Minus 1, plus 1. All right. So I'm going to give you some data point, and I'm going to ask you to classify it. So we're given the data point X, and it's missing X1. So we have X2, but we don't have X1. So if you look at this data and the likelihoods, you can compute the expected value of X1. And suppose that you do that and, you know, you get some number. Maybe it's 0. So what you could do is that, you know, one approach would be perhaps replace the missing data x1 with the expected value of it. So if you do that, then what do we get? We get basically replace our x. X becomes expected value of x1 and minus 1, which means if you look at the likelihood space here, so here's a data point down here, expected value of x1 is 0, x2 is minus 1, so this would be the data point. And so you would say probably that thing belongs to class 2. If you replace the missing data with the expected value of it. But look at the data that we actually have. So we actually have x2 is equal to minus 1. So if you look at this space here, when x2 is equal to minus 1, here's x2 is equal to minus 1, it's this line here. Right, so when x2 is equal to minus 1, this is not a bad choice, class 4. If I didn't know anything about x1, if I didn't know where x1 is, then this would not be a bad choice here, giving me x4. So in principle, how do I proceed? So here's what I have. I have some vector x, and I got some good data. I'm going to call it xg, and I have some bad data, xb. So x is just one data point. And part of it is good, part of it is bad. So can we classify with just the data that we have, which is the good data? What if we want to do that? So what I want to know is that if you don't have some data, do you throw the whole thing away, or can you still classify with the part of the data that you have? Does that make sense? So you have a vector space, you have a sample, part of it is missing. What do you do in that scenario? Let's do a little bit of math so you can see how to proceed. So what you want to know is the probability of belonging to some class I given just the good data, xg. Well, that's equal to the joint probability times the marginal, right? So now let's write, what is this joint probability? Well, it's, you know, I've basically done is that I've taken the joint probability of that class and vector x, which is made up of some good data and some bad data. And what I've done is that I've integrated out the bad data. Which is just my normal joint probability, integrate out the bad data. And then divided by the marginal. So what is this? Well, this P of CI and X, the joint probability, is just the conditional that we always do, the likelihood, times the prior probability of that class. But then you integrate out the bad data. So this is something that we can work on a little bit. So suppose that my prior probability, the prior probability, suppose, is some constant q. So I can take it out of the, it's not dependent on the x variable that we're interested in. So how do we integrate out a variable? So how do we integrate out a variable? So how do I take the likelihood, and I integrate out some component of the x variable. So suppose my x variable is made up of two things, x1 and x2. And so this is described by some normal distribution, which has mean mu1, mu2, and some variance, sigma 1, 1 squared, sigma 1, 2. All right, so this is how I write my normal distribution. It has this mean and this variance. So when I say integrate out a variable, so when I want to take the integral of the joint probability of x dx2, what I mean is that this vector here, the probability of that, integrate out one of the variables. And so this is p of x1. If you integrate out one of the other variables, you end up with the variable that remains. And if these are normal distributions, then it can be shown that p of x1 is just a normal with mu1, the mean, and its variance. So this term here, p of x given c1, integrate out the bad data, what remains is the probability of the good data given that class. So it's going to have some mean and some variance. If we use normal distributions to represent it, then what this means is that the integral of probability of your data given that it's in some class, and you integrate out the bad data, what this is equal to is some normal with mean mu of your good data and some variance covariance of your good data. And so when you don't have the data, part of your data, you compute a likelihood based on only the good data. And then you say, based on this good data only, what is my posterior probability? So let's go back to our example. So what does it mean to integrate out a data point? So if I don't have x1, then all I have is this dimension x2. So in this space, I have something here, I have something here, and then another one here. So all of this is projected onto x2. Then what you're going to see is that if all you have is x2, the most likely posterior probability is class 4. Very different result than if you replace it by the mean. So when you're missing data, you form likelihoods based on the good data that you have.
So basically, you're just collapsing the data on one variable.
Yeah. In general case, you are ignoring the likelihoods associated with the variable that you don't have data for. You're recomputing likelihoods only over the space that you have data for, the good data. Yeah, that's
right. So you should do this process 4 times for each class.
That's right. That's right. Together. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. All right, guys. Good to see you. See you Thursday.
So when you have missing data.